Hi, good morning, everybody. This is the Brazoria County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce morning discussion. And, you know, we host these morning discussions on various different topics, but today is sponsored by UTMB Health. And we're going to be talking a little bit about men's health, right? So for me, your host, I'm Alex Pena, and I'm an ambassador with the chamber here in Brazoria County. And I work for Increased Financial, you know, and just a little bit about what I do. I prevent my clients from failing financially by helping them make smart decisions with their money. Money. But today we're not talking about money. We're going to be talking about men's health. And I did want to introduce Dr. E, if you could tell us a little bit about yourself and what you got going on.
Thank you so much. And it is a pleasure to be here and to be able to contribute to the overall health of our community in a larger scale and a greater scope. A little bit about myself. My name is Dr. Peter Edemekong. I practice here in the Angleton Danbury campus, UTMB in Angleton. So I love to be involved in the community. A lot of my patients come from within the community and Lake Jackson involved as well, Angleton to be exact. I do primary care in addition to greater public health, population health, some infectious disease to be exact, HIV medicine, hepatitis C medicine. I also treat tropical diseases as well, tuberculosis, etc. And as you know, we are in the midst of one of the, I would rather say, worst pandemics in the history of mankind, to if I may use that term. That also put us in a sense that community health at a broader scale is very important. So is general public health, because if I'm healthy, you are healthy, everyone in the community is healthy, we technically turn around and protect each other. So what we do here in Angleton campus and the UTMB and the community is to keep each other safe. A little bit about the background. My background, I train family medicine in addition to preventive medicine as well. I do primary healthcare, global healthcare in addition to population healthcare. And for the purpose of our meeting today is to discuss what it is that we need to keep our population healthy. For today is the topic is to cover men's health, and I'll be very happy to contribute to the greater care of our community and to the men in our community. And so I'll leave the floor to you.
Well, thank you, Dr. E. That was fantastic. Thank you for sharing that, by the way. So what is men's health?
Well, men's health is, by definition, healthcare that is given in specific to the men in our community.
Sure.
That covers mental health,
mm-hmm.
physical health,
mm-hmm.
emotional health, and the overall scale of medical well-being. So if I'm doing well socially, financially, which is your specialty in this case,
right?
Family-wise, friends, community, overall that contributes to my well-being as a person,
mm-hmm.
as a male, and that also, I believe, is relative to other men in our community.
I can definitely agree with that. So I was telling our president, Gina, when she, you know, gave me this opportunity to host this morning discussion with you on men's health, I definitely jumped on it because, you know, I'm kind of sort of taking my next step in, I guess, my health journey, because I really, you know, a quarantine era or whatever you want to call it, sort of did a number on me like it did most people, right? It's either you came out, you know, in better health than when you walked in, or completely the opposite. There's really no in between, right? So, you know, come January, actually, you know, I got on a scale for the first time, and I couldn't even tell you how long, a few years. And I was like, oh my goodness, quarantine definitely hit me hard. So this is really, you know, near and dear to my heart, because I've really been taking the steps, you know, these past few months to really get my health in check, because, you know, I stepped on the scale, and I'm really not embarrassed. I stepped on the scale and I weighed 388 pounds, and I was like, oh no, that's not it. I have to make a change. So right now I'm actually down 22 pounds over the last 3 months, just been, you know, dieting and exercising, sweating and everything. And it's been great, man. You know, men's health is definitely, you know, I get sometimes overlooked, and we're just here to shed some light on that. So thank you again for talking with me about it.
Absolutely. So in relation to what you just shared with us, by the way, thank you. Yes, absolutely. it is very easy to ignore our overall health and well-being while we trying to make ends meet. So basically, we go home to our families, to our friends, we get up the following morning, we're back again at work, and we push the limits in the process. Question is, we sleep well? Do we eat well? Do we exercise? If we are on a certain treatment, do we follow that recommendation for those treatments? It's easy to fall out of the recommended or daily routine. So let's take, for instance, weight management. Okay, for our purpose today, I'm not going to use the word obesity, because we have to start from our healthy weight in order to go to a stage that saying, in regards to weight, are we healthy or not? So I want to focus on weight. What is weight? Weight management is what we see. Let's say we turn 18, how much do we wear in a year? How much do we lose? How many pounds do we lose or gain? In 5 years, how are we doing with that journey to maintain what is considered a healthy weight? Mm-hmm. And as you know, there's something called body mass index. Mm-hmm. Regards to body mass index, the short form of that is BMI. Mm-hmm. So basically, we start seeing, not even in our older year, even when while we are young, for all the young men out there, any body mass index or BMI that goes above 95 percentile, which is a scale that we use to calculate that weight management, anything that goes above that puts us in a rank that becomes unhealthy and also can pose medical risk to our overall health, because that actually can create additional risk. So how do we come to determine what is healthy or not? We use things like, do we have blood pressure? Mm-hmm. High blood pressure, in addition to that, which we'll likely cover today. And the baseline is any blood pressure that is above 130 over 80 puts us at a risk that becomes unhealthy. That's number one. Number two, what is the increased skin fold around our waist? How much of those weight do we carry are they proportionate? Let's say our abdomen or our tummy, mm-hmm. our arms, our legs, our hip, our legs, or in this case, the neck ratio. So you will notice that if someone gains weight, sometimes some people store weight different places in the body. Mm-hmm. Let's use the head and neck for our purpose today. Mm-hmm. If we gain weight and we add increased skin to our neck, you will find out that we find it sometimes difficult to breathe. And at night, we tend to snore. If someone snores, they're not exchanging the oxygen that we need to keep our body healthy. And when that happens for a longer time, it can create other problems. Mm-hmm. Let's say in addition to increased neck ratio, the extra body and the fat tissue in the neck becomes a problem. It creates a difficult situation for the airway to open up and exchange the air that we need to breathe to get the right amount of oxygen to keep us going. Mm-hmm. So how do we measure that and make sure that that increased weight does not contribute to other health problems? High blood pressure, diabetes, other health care problems. We look at the blood glucose. In this case, fasting blood glucose, we can use that. We look at the cholesterols in the body and we check our liver. What are common practices that can contribute to increased weight? In those cases, we can talk about our diet is number one. Are we active? By active, meaning, do we burn enough calories in a day to be able to maintain what our body needs that is healthy? Are we eating right? Or while trying to make ends meet, are we just eating from the restaurants? If it is a restaurant, is it a fast food restaurant or it is one that is cooked well? Mm-hmm. What are the ingredients, the components of a meal? Do we have a lot of salt in there? Do we have a lot of fat content or cholesterol risk from mm-hmm. what we actually consume? So those are some of the immediate things that we look at. Then if that weight stays unmanaged for a longer time, it contributes to the risk of being obese. What is obesity? Obesity is anybody weight that becomes unhealthy and contribute potentially to healthcare risk. Mm-hmm. So we look at weight management. Are we being overweight? If we are being overweight, by how much of a percentage or ratio are we overweight? And if someone becomes overweight, does it turn into obesity? What type of obesity do we have? Is it the one that can be managed well so that way we don't have the contributing healthcare risk that mm-hmm. can pose a long-lasting impact and risk to our overall health? So those are the questions that we likely ask. And as we get to answer those, mm-hmm. we can take it stages by stages and we can explore and see what are the things that we can do to be able to keep and manage a healthier weight in order to be able to be healthy overall.
Well, thank you for that, Dr. E. I know you mentioned a few of them, but you know, there are some pretty common, you know, health conditions that do generally affect men. I know you mentioned, you know, the blood pressure, the high cholesterol, weight management and all that. But if you wanted to, touch on that a little bit more, generally just affect men, because I feel like these affect not just men, but also women as well.
Yes. So yes, like I mentioned when we first started, what I just talked about, weight overall is not a problem for men. We see it in children, we see it in women, and it is something that we should have a broader discussion on how to prevent, because, you know, as a community, as a family unit, everyone is important.
Sure.
If we have a a healthier population, then overall, what we spend on our health as we get older becomes less and less. And as you know, healthcare is one of the contributing factors for financial difficulty, which in this case is your specialty.
Yes, I actually, you know, I deal with that quite a bit. You know, doing some level of retirement planning with my clients. I do kind of preach, you know, health as well, because if your health isn't intact when you retire, more than likely it may dwindle your retirement savings. So that's sort of something that I definitely take seriously, because as you know, healthcare costs and just medical insurance costs and everything rises on average of, I think it was 4 to 5% a year. So that's definitely something that we take seriously. So here, Dr. Yee, let me ask you this. So these general, you know, common health conditions concerning men's health, do you think that these conditions affect their, you know, just everyday personal and professional lives? You know, how they act, you know.
So the question, if I may rephrase this, do the general health for men in this case affect everyday life?
Yes.
So basically what that means is activities of daily living. I'm going to start, what is activities of daily living? Activities of daily living means we're able to get up, take a bath or shower by ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
We're able to walk. We're able to brush our teeth, comb our hair, cook meals for ourselves, clean our rooms, our houses, and put on dresses by ourselves without the help of somebody or someone else. Overall general health for men, what we've seen is number one, lifestyle. Lifestyle is very important.
Yes.
We've already discussed about what we eat, but the other thing is what we drink and not drink. And does someone smoke or not smoke? So, you know, there is the general view that when someone is young, when we are young, we are invincible. We don't have health problems. We can keep moving. And as we get older, age is not on our side. It can only go up. It doesn't come down.
Right.
So we take our body like a brand new machine, basically. Let's put it that way. If that machine is new, it can run well, no problem. As that machine gets older, it needs maintenance. So for us, human beings, what do? We need to keep an eye on our overall health. That starts with our behavior, what we eat, what we drink, and how active we are. So take a human body. When someone is a baby, hopefully we're born brand new. There is no health problems. Then we're 5 years old, 10 years old. Then 18 is a maybe magic number in some states.
Yeah.
At that age, can someone go to the store and buy a cigarette? Or at age 21, is in most states legal age to drink alcohol?
Mm-hmm.
How do we celebrate that? A lot of people drink a lot of alcohol at that instant because there is freedom to be able to participate in the social gathering.
Yes.
Be able to have access to alcohol, or maybe in some instance, cigarette, or in worst case scenario, some other controlled substance.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of drugs in the streets that, you know, people use for social recreation. So starts with let's start with alcohol. What is risk for alcohol use? Is an acceptable form of recreation socially. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people will tell you, I drink socially. Question is, how much does that person drink?
And how often?
And how often? For some people, the definition of socially means I drink a bottle of beer a day after work to relax, maybe watch a game or with my friends. For other people, it could be 2, 3, 4, 5.
Mm-hmm.
There's a set number of, if someone drinks X amount of alcohol a day, that is called alcohol, excess alcohol use. It turns into alcohol dependence. Then it turns into alcohol abuse.
Mm-hmm.
Now the question comes, does that compromise our daily function? Our family, our jobs, missing from work or school, in regards to men, how does that affect our overall well-being, emotional health, physical health, or maybe you can even add spiritual health, mm-hmm. if we venture into that, which I'll keep out of the conversation today, because that by itself is a totally different topic.
I agree. You know?
What risk does alcohol use pose to our health? We have the cardiovascular or the heart health. Number one, we have risk with developing diabetes later on in life.
Mm-hmm.
Other healthcare problems. For men, we talk about erectile dysfunction. Then we talk about bowel function, which is abdominal health. Does that create other problems? So the three I likely will touch on today is cardiovascular health, endocrine health, which we'll discuss in regards to diabetes, and overall men's well-being, fertility, which we can have what is known as overall erectile problems. Then it becomes infertility, then the list goes on and on and on and on. In addition to that, our pancreas takes the hit for all the activities that we likely do, which in this case can add as what you consider abdominal problem. You can see someone, they said, oh, doctor, I have abdominal pain. And then we get into the social history and we find out that there is smoking involved, there is unhealthy eating involved, mm-hmm. and also there is alcohol use involved, which then turns into heart health, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, history of uncontrolled blood pressure, which then gives us a risk for heart disease and cholesterol. Then we come down eventually as we get older to having problems with blood sugar, which is diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
All of these in regards to men's health leads to one factor. We cannot complete our activities of daily living. We start missing work. We start missing our family's social gathering. We see ourselves more and more in the clinic hospital setting to get treated. Then comes the questions, do we adhere to that treatment or not?
Mm-hmm.
I think Dr. Alzweri just joined us, so I'll give him a chance to come on board and see and contribute to our conversation today.
Good morning, Dr. Leif. Thank you for joining us. I believe you're on mute.
Yeah. How you doing, guys?
Very good.
All right. Sorry, I was in the OR this morning. And thank you for the Dr. Edemekong for, I'm sure he did better job than me. You know, he keeps patients live and clicking and doing all the right things.
Well, that's good to hear. Dr. Leif, we gave Dr. Yi some time to introduce himself now that you joined us today, if you don't mind just giving us, just a little bit about yourself and what you got going on.
Absolutely, absolutely. First, thank you for the great invitation.
Absolutely.
We're happy to reach out to our community partners, Brazoria County, Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, we appreciate the partnership and we wanna work together to improve the health of our community. My name is Leith Alzweri. I'm a urologist by training, and I'm the director for men's health and male reconstructive genitourinary surgery at UTMB Men's Health. In a nutshell, all the problems below the waist and sometimes above the waist comes to me. We're here to make sure that men have great quality of life And, I do have an office in Angleton campus and also in League City. Our program mainly, focuses on improving quality of life. As I said, main problems like low testosterone, erectile dysfunction, problems with enlarged prostate, and kidney stones.
All right, Dr. Leith, thank you for sharing that with me. That's amazing. So just to go back to what we were talking about with Dr. E, so we were just talking about just the general conditions of, common health that affect the daily living of on men, on their personal and professional lives. And I just kind of wanted to touch on that after we just got done. Like I told Dr. E earlier, I took this panelist opportunity that the CEO of Brazoria County Hispanic Chamber gave me because I really jumped on it because I just started my health journey, getting my health back on track this year, actually. I told Dr. E that I stepped on the scale and I didn't like it. So I started to change that. And just to touch on what we were just talking about, how it affects, just your personal lives and your professional lives. You mentioned that people were, sleepwalking and sleepworking and everything. I kind of felt that, the overall fogness in the brain throughout the day, that I was just kind of like there, but not there at the same time. And I realized that had a lot to do with my diet and how out of shape I was. Luckily, I had a mentor here at where I work at, and he kind of pointed me in the right direction. Like, hey, I know you're young and you think you can do all these things, because I'm 24, but I kind of felt the difference from when, I was 18 to now on just overall, feeling like crap or just being kind of lost in the brain fog. And it was affecting my work day, right? I was less productive. I was just sluggish, fatigued. I'd hit a wall every day. It felt like I hit a wall around midday, and I would lose a good 2 hours of good working time, just because of my health. And I never realized it. I just thought I was young. I could go out there and do it. But luckily I had a mentor who kind of pointed me in the right direction. And, now I've lost 22 pounds over the past few months. And thank you. My energy's up. I don't experience brain fog, only when I get, lack of sleep, but high energy, high focus. My productivity has gone up a lot, not only at work, but at the house. I recently proposed to my, I was going to say girlfriend, but she is my fiance now. And she's loving it because, I'm not as lazy.
Congratulations. I don't have sound effects. I would have put some party sound effects for you.
Thank you.
Congratulations as well.
Thank you. It's been awesome. I'm glad I decided to take care of my health as I take this next step in my life, because if I can't take care of myself, then I definitely can't take care of her. But she's loving it. Like I said, I have a lot more energy, a lot more productivity at the house when doing things around the house. So she's loving it and I'm loving it. And
that's fantastic. I'm glad to hear that. That's great. I think what you said is the story of most men. Mm-hmm. The main thing is that if you think about investment, okay, if somebody wants to invest for their retirement, they have to do it early and do it regularly.
Yep.
Because it doesn't happen overnight. Same thing for health. One has to invest in their health. And how do you invest in your health? You invest daily and early. So right. You make right decisions every day. Sometimes they can be painful. It's foregoing that nice high calorie meal, or hitting the gym or going for a run or, just doing any physical activity. If you do that regularly, then you're investing in your health. I think what we share with Dr. Edemekong, we have many mutual patients, is most men, they don't look after themselves. they go through huge stress, which we all under, you know, homework, family commitments, you know, et cetera. They don't have time to exercise. They don't eat well. And most importantly, they don't go and see a friendly urologist or a friendly primary care. And I was like, you talk to the patient, doc, I'm fine. I never see a doctor. I was like, that's not a good thing, my friend. If you service your car once or twice a year, I think you need to service your most precious asset, which is your health, at least once or twice a year. You have Dr. Edemekong, you have Dr. Alzweri. If you don't like them, you know, there are other doctors, but go and see, talk to someone. So, anyway, and then they come suddenly, doc, I just have one small problem. You know, I'm just having some problem with like intimacy or erectile dysfunction, whatever, but actually it's a sign of heart disease. Or I feel low, or I feel I have low energy. I feel tired all the time. It's low testosterone because they're not active. They're not eating well. And like it catches up to them at some point. So, you know, I think the most important thing is just raising awareness, acting early, doing small steps every day, yeah? And collaborating with your friendly doctors in your local community. And, you know, and I think, you know, with the Brazoria County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, spreading the word, you know, that's the most important thing, because we're not talking just about ourselves. You know, when we talk about men's health, we talk about husbands, fathers, grandfathers, sons, you know, we're talking half of the society. So, you know, we want to collaborate all together so we all have, you know, good quality of life. Because if someone is not able to work or someone is sick or affected, they affect their families as well. I mean, and, you know, just so we don't keep going. And if there are any questions, you know, more than happy to take them. I'm not quite sure how many people are on the call, sir?
We got about, including ourselves, 5.
So I just want to add to what the Dr. Alzweri said. Like I did when we first started, what I said was, take a brand new car to our body. Once that car comes out of the factory, no problems. Then we talk about oil change, and we talk about maintenance, and we talk about timing belts and all of that stuff. As men, most men love cars or anything mechanic or electronic. We have to keep that up to date, in good condition. So once we have 10, then we have age 18, 20, which is when most of the social activities is considered legal. We start smoking or we start drinking alcohol, to be exact, and everything goes downhill from there. And as I was saying, most men use alcohol as a form of social activities. We sit down with friends, families, and we have a good time. And we start from a bottle to 2 bottles, then you find some men 6-pack, 12-pack. All of that contributes to overall healthcare well-being. A year, 2 years, 3 years, we start developing problems like blood pressure, cholesterol. All of that, boom, adds into additional healthcare problem. Weight management then turns to problems like diabetes, then intimacy problems, fertility problems. That's when a lot of folks starts coming to the doctor, said, doctor, I have this problem. But then we go back in history, we find out, what have we been doing for the past 5 years, 10 years, maybe 15 years? Or for some folks that smoke, how long have you smoked? It starts creating problems in our blood vessels, then, which then, in the case of men, the most important pride and asset is, can we be intimate or not? That's where a lot of men will start coming, said, I've been having this problem for a long time. I don't know what's going on. Then, like you were saying, Mr. Alexander, being sluggish, not being able to be productive, getting up and missing productive hours of work. Now, everything in our society goes back to the dollar. So the dollar is important, and a lot of folks chase the dollar and ignore overall healthcare being. And we don't exercise, we don't sleep well, which contributes to overall risk for us developing problems like heart disease, breathing problems, cholesterol problems, intimacy problems, emotional problems, and social stress. So the number one stress adds to the risk that we are predisposed from our family line of genetics, which we'll likely discuss as well today.
That is actually something that I was going to bring up next, but I know you said something about sleep. We actually, me and my fiance actually just invested in a new bed. And let me tell you, we have been sleeping incredible the past week and a half. It's made all the difference, you know, to get a full night's sleep, to be rested and ready to go the next morning. So like you said about family history and everything, I did want to touch on that a little bit. Like you said, we wanted to discuss on that. So how big is family history when it comes to just general healthcare conditions that affect, you know, this I guess the daily lives of men and everything, because it's kind of a question that I also want to know, and I'm sure everybody else wants to know, because on my family, on both sides of my family, we actually have people who have diabetes. It runs pretty thick on both sides. So that's definitely something that I all want to know, and I'm sure everybody else want to know. And I did say earlier that we had only five, but we actually have 26 people on here. So if you have any questions, just shoot away.
So first and foremost, family history is something that all of us cannot escape. Let's start from there. We are born with certain genetics, which means what comes from both our moms and our dads. That puts us at a risk that we can manage, but not escape. What does that mean? You mentioned diabetes, that diabetes is high blood glucose or blood sugar, that if we don't control that well, it becomes a problem. And for our general purpose, we can use numbers like that blood sugar, what is considered hemoglobin A1C. On average, we look at that every 3 months for those that are having serious blood sugar problem. So let's say it's above 6.5. That's putting us at a greater risk for other health problems. Family history and genetics is something that is what you will call biologic and on the side of genetics. Is something that we can manage. If someone has a history of diabetes in their family, there is a greater chance of them developing that at a later years in their life as we get older, past 18, 20, into the 30s, the 40s, 50s, 60s. How can we manage that? That's what I want to focus on. By number one, being active. Number two, eating right. Number three, exercising. Number four, not doing anything that can add to that. What does that mean? Alcohol use, smoking, and using all any other illegal drugs or anything that may contribute to our overall well-being. How do we manage weight and blood sugar to be able to keep ourselves healthy, even with the family history of that particular medical problem? In this case, high blood sugar. We need to maintain our weight on a healthy ratio. Earlier, we talked about what is called body mass index, BMI. There is a scale, which in the age of Google, you know, we can look that up basically. Recommendation is when anybody goes above 18 into the 20s, into the 30s, 40s, those become severe as the number increases for general purpose and understanding today. As that body mass index goes up, it adds to the greater risk of blood sugar, which is diabetes, then contributes to the risk of heart disease. So general recommendation is keep that number as lower as possible. When you look at the scales and the ranking, they will say 18, then in the 20s, and then into the 30s. There is a program that has been put in places in the schools, in our high schools, elementary schools, et cetera, for healthy eating. In addition to, I believe the former President Barack Obama and the wife tried a program, to be exact, Michelle Obama, and I believe all the president that has come, he's been in place. I believe they call it Let's Move. Any physical activities is good investment. any good eating is good investment. Any good risk management and stress management is good investment for long term for our health. So let's start from activity. When they say be active, it doesn't mean go out and run 2 miles, 3 miles, 5 miles. The recommendation now is if we have activity that keeps us at a moderate intensity of at least 150 minutes and above within a week, that is considered a step in the right direction. What does that mean? That means that we burn the calories from what we eat and drink, and at the end of the day, we stay within a healthier calorie intake. What does calorie mean? It means that the alcohol we drink, the food we eat, all of that have energy component. That energy is broken down by our body into numbers. There are healthier calorie intake that at the end of the day, we have to calculate based on what we eat and drink. There are numbers set in place, which each body may have a different setting. But overall, the recommendation is what gets in our body and the energy we use or expand should remain healthier overall for us to be able to sustain a healthier lifestyle. If we don't do that, that calorie stays in our body is a fuel that is not used. It can contribute to future problems. In this case, we're still talking about blood sugar, which is one of the contributing healthcare risk and factor to our general and overall health being. So what does that mean? Instead of drinking alcohol, we stay close to water. Water is the best friend. If you go anywhere, you do anything, we use water to bathe, to cook, to do a lot of things. So instead of opting for alcohol, we opt for water. Instead of eating out every day, we cook at least 1 to 2 meals that is well prepared. Instead of smoking, we cut back on that. And for folks that smoke, we can do what is called nicotine replacement therapy, which comes in the form of a patch and said, instead of vaping or actually lighting up an actual cigarette, for those that have already smoked, we use alternative to be able to cut back on those circumstances or lifestyle or the social habits that can contribute to a greater and future health problem. And going back to family history, if we have the risk for heart disease, for diabetes, for cholesterol, anything that can cost us a dollar amount to treat and take care of that, the better investment is to find alternatives. Eat lots of fruits and veggies, number one. Number two, stay well hydrated, have a better stress management, which starts with sleep. Recommendation is to at least 7 hours of sleep to 8, for some people to 9, depending on our body and how we walk and live, to be able to maintain a healthier mental state. Because if we lack sleep, you're going to be groggy the following day. You're not going to be wide awake. The attention span decreases. We make mistakes at work. Driving on the road is a risk to get into accident. Some people use coffee or energy drink. We all know about Red Bulls to stay awake. And we live in a society that we do shift work. If someone is working night shift or first, second, third shift, when do we go to bed? When do we get up? When do we get in the car? Do we sit in the car past 40 minutes a day in total? We drive long distances to go to work and back. Mm-hmm. How much time do we spend in our cars and not be active? And you see, in this day and age, lots of traffic on the road. We sit in the car, we eat in the car. Then some people smoke in the car. Some people are actually drinking in the car. All of those eventually will add up, and it catches up. It's basically payback time. We get into the 30s, the 40s, or even the 20s. then we start seeing that our body is not responding to us moving anymore. And that puts us and create a risk factors in addition to our family history, which is not on our side. So idea is to try to do the things that can help us maintain the risk that we have from our family, mm-hmm. history-wise, to be able to stay ahead for our health.
Well, thank you for answering that, Dr. E. We have time for one more question, and I wanted to give it to Dr. Lay. Someone asked him a question about, what is urology and how it affects or how it impacts their overall health, and how should they address that annually or just when symptomatic?
Yeah, so I mean, generally speaking, I think let's just talk about common conditions that would affect men. So for young men in their late teens and 20s, we recommend doing regular testicular exam to detect for testicular cancer. Usually they will have painless swelling in the testicles. If a man has a swelling testicle lump or they need to come and see us. For men in the 30s and 40s, we're seeing increasing cases with low testosterone, feeling tired, low sex drive, unable to exercise, feeling sleepy all the time. So that could be low testosterone. So they don't have to receive testosterone therapy. And I would caution against going to the low testosterone clinics or men's health clinic. They do a great job, but probably they would be best served by seeing the primary care physician or a urologist. In 40s and 50s, men were having problems with their enlarged prostates, some of them, and also low testosterone. And then you have erectile dysfunction, which could be a sign of a heart disease, diabetes, or hypertension. So in a nutshell, I guess most men above the age of 40 would benefit from having a friendly urologist see them once a year. Same way you take kids for a well exam every year or every 6 months, a man should go and have a well man exam with a primary care physician or urologist once a year. What do we do in that encounter? We ask them about level of energy, their sex drive, their erectile function, if they have any urinary problems. If someone is waking up 2 to 3 times a night to pass urine, men in their 50s and 60s, that's not normal. That interrupts lifestyle. That could be a sign of an enlarged prostate. If there's a family history of prostate cancer, we need to do examination of the prostate and the PSA. Women are much smarter. They live longer. They live longer because they go and see the doctors. Men don't. They come when it's too late. So we want to partner with the Brazoria County in Hispanic Chamber of Commerce and all our partners to raise awareness. Hey, even if you don't have a problem, go and see Dr. Edemekong. Go and see Dr. Alzweri. Go and see your primary care physician, your urologist, because, sometimes someone will have an, increased blood sugar, not aware, diabetes. They may have blood in the urine, and they need to be worked up for cancer or elevated PSA. So I think there are things that we can do to improve, health all over. I hope that answered the question.
Yes. Well, thank you for that, Dr. Lath. I did want to get one more in before we close up today's discussion. Being that you said women annually get checked more often than men, now that we're trying to create awareness for that, what tests and screenings should, men be doing to get out ahead of this before you, like you said, it's too late?
So the first thing is that you find a friendly primary care physician like Dr. Edemekong. So you go and see him or her, and then they will check blood pressure. They will check, for lipids. I don't want to steal the Dr. Edemekong thunder. He's more knowledgeable than me in that, but generally speaking, they will do basic tests to make sure that they're in good health. If they flag up on, urinary symptoms or, doc, I feel tired, erectile dysfunction. Dr. Edemekong is a great colleague of mine. We practice the same, kind of building. He will send them to me. Okay. Sometimes it's the other way around. A man comes to me with erectile dysfunction, diabetes, and hypertension, and he's like, "Doc, I want to get fixed." I was like, "I can help you with some problems, but you really need a manager." What I tell men in a nutshell: every man is important for his family. Every man is the star of his family. If the Houston Rockets and NFL players have managers, every man should have a manager. All right. You are important to your family. Your health is important. So go and find a good manager like Dr. Edemekong or Dr. Alzweri. UTMB has plenty of good doctors who are better than me in every specialty, you know? Or go somewhere else, it doesn't matter, but just find someone who will be your manager, you know? If you have a CPA who does your taxes, I hope so, I don't know, you need to find the doctor who can help with you with your health. You know, I tell you, I have men in their 90s. Dr. Edemekong, the very few and far, but all of them have invested in their health. If we start today and we just plant the seed of convincing men to go and see a doctor, I know it's tough, but we're not that, you know, bad. We can be friendly sometimes, not all the time, you know? So please, you know, spread the word. We're here to help you. And finally, I just want to say before I go, if there's any opportunity for other talks, if you want to come and give deliver a talk, you know, to an audience or interact, we are happy to do that. We are from the community to the community, and we're going to be your partners. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Dr. Dr. Laith. We're about to close it up. I just wanted to say-
One last thing. So my last name is Alzweri. I know it's difficult, but I didn't choose it, man. I was given it. So imagine I give it to my kids too. So it's Alzweri. Alzweri, yeah? That's fine. Thank you.
Just to add to what Dr. Alzweri just said. So basically, I like the idea and the concept of finding a manager, and I think that's really good. And actually, that's what it is, in a nutshell. And Mr. Alexander, like you said, health is wealth. So we invest in ourselves when we're younger, so that way we can sustain that health as we get older, and we maintain the productivity. As Dr. Alzweri said, we're important to our families, so is our moms and sisters and our brothers, nieces, and nephews. If you're healthy, I'm healthy, Dr. Alzweri is healthy, and everybody on the call.
I'll be happy.
Yes.
I'll be happy.
So we'll find out that at the end of the day, as a community, if we are healthier, instead of putting the money at a later time, trying to fix the problem that we could have avoid it, we can use the money and do something else. Invest in our education, maybe buy a nice house, a nice car, or anything. Go on a travel instead of limiting ourselves. So I think to ask the question about what do men do to keep their health? So having regular checkup at least once a year is important. Eating healthier is important. Avoiding smoking is important. Avoiding alcohol is important. Eating well includes, is it red meat or not? Is it something that is fried or cooked? Do we eat fruits or not? The easier way to invest is go to a produce store, buy things off the shelf, cook that meal, eat healthier meals at least 3 square meals a day. You can snack if you burning energy or in a job or situation that you are a lot more active. Keep well hydrated by drinking good, plain water. We are in the summer months. It's gonna be hot. Be careful, don't sit in a hot car, or don't spend time outside. For some of our men that do construction work, people collapse. Blood pressure goes up when we stress. So at least keep an eye on the blood pressure. Invest in a blood pressure machine. It costs max $30. There are some $15, $20. Measure your blood pressure at least once a day if you don't feel well, or at least once or twice a week if you know you don't have blood pressure problems. If you're having eye problems, go to the eye doctor, or go to any doctor, say, "Doc, I'm having problems with my vision." They're gonna send you in the right direction. So let's do that. And I think in the long run, with or without risk from our family, which sometimes we cannot avoid, we'll all maintain a healthier lifestyle.
Well, thank you guys. Thank you, Dr. Alzweri and Dr. Edemekong. My name is Jean Aguirre Adams, and I'm the president CEO of the Brazoria County Hispanic Chamber. On behalf of the Hispanic Chamber, I wanna thank you guys for giving this important information. We're very big on giving this, you know, getting a lot of this information out to our community, especially if it has to do with health. thank you guys. And thank you, UTMB Health, for sponsoring this event. And I've learned a lot, actually. I've learned a lot. What we usually do with these videos is we edit them, and then we'll put them on YouTube so that way they can be shared within all of our social media. So we'll be pushing that out there. Thank you to our ambassador, Alex Pena, for taking this on. You did an excellent job. So I think we're going to close here. Anybody else had anything else to say before we leave?
I just wanted to say thank you to both the doctors that joined us today. I learned a lot. I'm continuing to learn on my health journey that I'm taking right now. And hopefully I can, you know, I won't have to come see y'all in such drastic measures, but thanks again. I had fun. Thank you, Gina, for letting me have this opportunity, and y'all have a great day.
You know, thank you all for having us, and more than happy to talk to you again. If any activities, just, you know, we're available, and we would like to partner with you. Stay safe all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.